Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. It's lovely to see you in this new year. This is not quite what we expected. We thought we'd be gathering together, but that's not the case. But we're glad you could join us online. Let me start worship by reading some verses from a psalm, a tiny little psalm, but one of my favourites, Psalm 131. My heart is not proud, Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me. But I have calmed and quieted myself. I'm like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child, I am content. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore. Well, we do indeed put our hope in the Lord. In this constantly, rapidly changing world, we do trust him. And we do trust his love. We do trust his forgiveness. And we do trust in his grace. So let's sing about that right now.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Well, when we think of all that God has done for us, how can we not offer him our praise? How can the whole world not respond to him in praise? Let's listen to these beautiful and timeless words. All creatures of our God and King, let's offer our praise.
creatures of our garden keep. Lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam. Thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 Thou rushing wind, thou art so strong. The clouds that sail in heaven along. Oh, their creator bless and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh,
please join me in prayer. Holy God, our Creator and Preserver, we bow our hearts before You today. We thank You for every blessing, for love, for life, for hope, and for all that lies ahead. We thank You for sustaining us in our past. We thank You for holding us in our future. Today we acknowledge and thank You that through Your Spirit we are never alone. Help us in the year ahead to look to You as our guide and to trust You to be God with us. Although we cannot gather in person, be with us in worship today and pour out Your blessing, we pray. Amen.
The Bible reading this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 to 32 in the NIV version. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you.
Well, thank you, Jane, for that scripture reading. Reading scripture is not as easy as it looks. I always think when I read that particular scripture, to be honest, I always wonder about the brawling bit, right? Put off brawling, right? Stop brawling. And you think, what was church like? What was church like for the Ephesians? Anyway, I wasn't going to talk about that. I wanted to talk about this idea of New Year's resolutions. So here we are, our first Sunday in the new year. And I don't know if you make them. Personally, I never do, but I always think I should. But I wondered if we did, what would be a New Year's resolution that we would make? And I think one of them would be, as a community of God's people, to commit ourselves to being a forgiving community, or more personally, that for each of us, to be a forgiver. Because forgiveness is one of the ways, I think, that we deal with our sin, we deal with our weakness. A Sunday school teacher once asked her class, what must we do to have our sins forgiven? And a boy replied, sin. And of course, sin is ever present, and so forgiveness is always necessary. Now, I do need to say a couple of things at the outset of this sermon. Forgiveness is not something that I'm particularly good at. There are some things that I preach about that I think I've got that right, and I can preach with authority. But this is not a subject on which I can preach with authority. Nevertheless, I think it matters. I also need to say that what I'm talking about today really comes from two authors, C.S. Lewis and a guy called Smeeds, and his book on forgiveness, which is really, really helpful. So first of all, let's think through this idea of what is forgiveness. What are we actually talking about? So we want to agree on our term. Forgiveness is love's powerful remedy when someone hurtfully wrongs us. All right, forgiveness is love's powerful remedy when someone hurtfully wrongs us. And there's some ideas to unpack in that. That is, when we have been hurt. And that is when it's been done to us. You can't forgive people for hurting others. I mean, you could, I guess. We could forgive the young person who killed that family on Oatlands, and we're going to talk about that family in a moment. We could forgive him, but it doesn't mean all that much, I think. I'm also, when we're talking about forgiveness, not talking about being polite, you know, ignoring snubs or dealing with frustrations. And I'm not talking about dealing with disappointments with people, an ongoing kind of dissatisfaction with someone who doesn't meet our expectations. I mean, if every one of those, when people disappointed us, if every one of those required forgiveness, our life would be a revolving series of reconciliations. And I also need to say that forgiveness is when the hate the sin and not the sinner bit doesn't imply, because, in fact, who it is that is sinning matters a great deal. I did once have this girl in my life, and she would often scream at me and sometimes ignore me and often didn't seem to understand me and at times was incredibly demanding. I even had to clean up after her mess. But really, I didn't mind because she was my daughter and her name was Montana and she was only a baby. You see, who it is matters. The context and the situation matters. It is who the person is that gives hurt its hurtfulness. A friend who steals $5,000 versus a stranger who steals $5,000. The hurt is more, isn't it, from the friend. I just can't believe they did that. They were my friend, we would say. So that's what we're talking about with forgiveness. We're talking about when people have hurt us. People we know have hurt us. Well, we might ask, why should we forgive? Well, the reason we have to forgive is actually because we cannot forget. Often because the action done to us is still hurting us and affecting us and influencing us. Something needs to be done about that. I mentioned the Abdallah family and that tragedy that happened when those children were killed quite close to where we are today in Oatlands. And how the family, who are Christians, said that they forgave the perpetrator. And in fact, when she talked about it recently, Layla Abdallah said, forgiveness is more for the forgiver than the forgiven. In a sense, the family had to learn how to forgive for their sake, for their own sake. So why should we do it? We do it for our own sake. We also forgive because Jesus tells us to. He talks about it in Matthew. Apparently, forgiving is a requirement for the Christian and a requirement for being forgiven ourselves. But it's not just selfish. We also forgive because it heals others. Forgiveness is the hope of the world. It's the only hope for nations, I think, as well. The only hope for the Middle East. The trouble and the enmity that lies between Palestine and Israel is for someone to start forgiving. Gandhi once said, if we all live by an eye for an eye, the whole world will one day be blind. Now, it's not that justice isn't important, don't get me wrong here. But don't let justice stop you forgiving. Sometimes we're reluctant to forgive others because it may grant the other person something they don't deserve. Somehow it will discount the wrong they have committed. No, that is not the case. Forgiveness is not excusing. In fact, the Abdallah family said, we forgive him, but we still hope justice is served. One of the reasons we don't forgive is because forgiveness is hard and it is confrontational. It's not a soft option to forgive people. And at the heart of it is this idea that forgiveness is in a way unfair. Forgiveness is extravagant and generous, and its aim is not justice. Its aim is healing. Revenge evens the score, but forgiveness wins the game. And so we give for our own sake. We give for the sake of others. We give, forgive because forgiveness heals the world. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Dead Man Walking. It's a very confronting film. It's really about the death penalty and about a nun who was a confessor in a church for men who were on death row. And if you've seen the movie, it deals with horrific crime. And I read a book called Forgiving the Dead Man Walking, and it was by a woman called Debbie Morris. And it was written after the film. And the reason she wrote it after the film was she was one of the victims of this particular person. In fact, in real life, there were two men who attacked her and her boyfriend, and attacked the boyfriend and left him for dead, and then abducted her and repeatedly assaulted her over a number of days. And she talked about her long road to forgiveness, to forgive the perpetrators. And she talks about forgiveness as a healing mechanism for her, not because she wanted to excuse them, not because she wanted to let them off the hook, but for her own sake. Well, if forgiveness matters that much, how should we forgive? Well, with difficulty, as we've said, but also by recognising that forgiveness is a deliberate act on our part. It requires tools. It requires us to understand what forgiveness is. And so there's a few terms I'm going to talk about, and the words will be on your screens. And the first is salvage. Sometimes we forgive for the sake of salvage, and this is where there is no relationship to restore. We're not looking for reconciliation. We're just finding a way to get over the hurt, to get on with our personal healing. Remember, sometimes the only person helped by this is the person who does the forgiving, and that was the case with Debbie Morris and Robert Willie. Another term we need to understand is that of restoration. Now, restoration or reconciliation needs a prior existing relationship and one you want to restore. And this is when forgiveness is necessary between friends and husbands and wives, between parents and their children. Now, sometimes, it must be said, full restoration is not possible, and we should give up on that goal. We can only forgive and reunite on the terms that time and circumstance allow. Sometimes the people we need to forgive are no longer alive. Nevertheless, forgiveness is possible. Another thing we need to grapple with forgiveness is insight. And this is a hard thing to do, to truly have insight into a situation. And we might need help from close friends or confidants or from therapists. We need to understand what has happened to us. We need to recognise and understand how we have been violated and who was responsible. You see, sometimes we lash out at people and it wasn't their fault. I remember talking to a husband and wife and something had happened in their relationship. And I remember talking to her about this and she was very angry with her leaders, very angry with her leaders. And I was taken aback by this because, in fact, the person who I wanted to be angry with was her husband. We need to make sure that we understand who was responsible. We need to understand exactly what has happened here, and that is insight. And we need to think through this idea of understanding as it relates to the other, to the person we need to forgive. We need to think, why were things done? Were there mitigating factors? Now, this is not to excuse them or to deny accountability, but an attempt to explain why it happened. And it may be that they were immature, and it may be that they were weak. It may be that they didn't understand what they were doing. Remember, this is not to excuse them, but to help ourselves understand. I always think about this with driving. I have a friend who was in the drug squad, and I remember complaining about some drivers who were doing some stupid things, speeding past, and he said, oh, could have been some of our team. And I said, oh, it's a beat-up old car, and he said, we use those, and we don't travel in pairs, we travel in ones or threes or whatever. And so whenever I see a beat-up old car go past me and there's a couple of young guys in it and they do something stupid, instead of getting angry, I think, well, maybe it's the drug squad, right? And there's a good reason for what they're doing. Lately, what I've started to do when people do silly things on the road, I seek to understand them. I think maybe they're an old person in their 60s and they can't drive properly anymore. So we seek to understand the other. One of the hardest parts, though, of forgiveness is recognition. And recognition in the sense of putting things into perspective. And this is what Lewis Smedes talked about. And it's the most powerful thought, I think, that was in his book. And I've said this before. Forgiveness involves the recognition that what they have done to us is not the deepest truth about them. Forgiveness involves the recognition that what they've done to us is not the deepest truth about them. Now, this can be hard. Think of someone who has hurt you, someone in your past who has deeply, deeply hurt you and has wounded you. And what happens is the hurt they have done is like a barrier between us. Now, imagine that person, and imagine that the greatest truth about them is that they are a loved child of God. The person who hurt you is a loved child of God. That is the deepest truth about them. They are not only the people who hurt us. This is not the totality of who they are. You see, when we forgive, we must make the hurt irrelevant to how we feel about them. To go back to Debbie Morris, she once said, in a book, in fact, she said, we don't sing amazing justice, we sing amazing grace. Justice didn't do a thing to heal me. Forgiveness did. So we might ask ourselves, how do we recognise forgiveness? How will we know it when we see it? How will we know when we've been able to forgive? Well, there's various ways, really. There's overt forgiving, words said, or opportunities of compensation. Sometimes there can be acts of healing for us. And I think we learn how to forgive from God. We learn how to offer healing to others. We learn how to say the words. We know what our attitude should be. You see, God looks at us and chooses to rediscover our humanity and remove the barrier created by sin. He doesn't allow that to obscure who we are. He looks at us and he loves us, and that is insight. And God recognizes that our sin against him is still not the deepest truth about us. God surrenders his right to get even, choosing instead to bear the cost of our sin in his own body. He sends his son to die for us because God seeks restoration and reconciliation. And God revises his feeling towards us and looks at us as a restored people, as his people. That's what all that stuff in the Bible and the stuff we sing about never remembering our sins anymore means. God chooses to look at us in a particular way. And this is God's recognition that we are his in spite of our sin. Our sin becomes irrelevant because we are his children. In Matthew's Gospel, in chapter 18, Peter very famously asked Jesus how often he was to forgive. Seven times, he thought he was being generous. And Jesus said, 70 times seven. Or, if you like, forgive again and again and again. And forgive some more and some more. Perhaps it would have been helpful if Peter had asked a follow-up question. If he'd said to Jesus, how do you forgive, Jesus? And perhaps if he had, Jesus would have said, watch me. I will forgive and forgive and forgive and forgive. And so Jesus on the cross, understanding the injustice of what was happening at a level we can't even imagine, he said, Father, forgive. Father, forgive. Forgiveness changes a family. Forgiveness changes a community. Forgiveness changes the church. Forgiveness changes our world. Why is forgiveness so hard? I don't know, but it is. It is. But be encouraged. If you're trying to forgive, if you set your feet on that path of forgiveness, even if you only manage to forgive in fits and starts, if you forgive today but then hate again tomorrow and have to forgive again the day after, you are a forgiver. Remember, most of us are amateurs at this. Forgive us, Lord. Pray with me. Holy God, God of forgiveness and love, we bring ourselves before you right now. And we pray that through your spirit of love, you'll help us to be forgivers. Help us to offer up again and again that holy act of forgiveness to those who have hurt us. May we be agents of healing. May we look to you as the source of forgiveness, as a model of forgiveness. Help us to love each other, Lord. Help us to be like you. We pray this prayer, believing it is possible in the name of your Son and through the power of your Spirit. Amen. Amen. Well, we need to finish with a song of affirmation. And we're going to do that now. We're going to sing a song, Your Name is Power. It speaks to this idea that God is the God who's at work in our lives. So let's praise him and thank him for all he is as we listen to this marvellous song.
answer to the darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. You are the voice that calls me on, louder than every lie, my sword in every fight. The truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. I know it is written, it is certain. I know that the world will never fail. I know that in every situation, you speak the power to prevail. Louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. When you speak, you scatter darkness, light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. When you speak, the church awakens, we believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. Your name is power over darkness, for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. Your name. Power.
Let me share a benediction with you. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before our Father's throne with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Saviour, be power, glory, majesty and authority, now and forevermore. Amen.
Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captive, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. Your name is power.